I don't think that's a very good idea, actually.
No?
I'm seeing someone.
Oh. I did. What's he like?
Doug is a journalist.
Oh. I just thought since you had so much free time on your hands.
He travels a lot. And I really like spending my time with you. I hope that's okay. You know, you're very sweet. Have you heard that before? You have this deer in the headlights quality.
Thank you. Well, if I was your boyfriend, I would not travel. Or if I did, I would take you with me. I hope he knows how to kiss you and all the rest.
It's between us.
Hi, everybody. I'm Peter Travers, and welcome to Popcorn, where we tell you what's happening at the movies. And my guest today, Kristen Stewart, doesn't have one movie opening this week, and she has two, because that's just who she is. In Woody Allen's Cafe Society, she's playing someone in the 1930s, and she's in the past. And in Equals, she's in the future. But lucky for us, I have Kristen Stewart in the present. When you work for Woody Allen, what's that like? It's the first time. So there's this reputation, you know, Woody making one movie a year. Any actor he calls on says, I'm going to do it. Mm-hmm. So is he standing there saying, doing line readings for you?
His line readings are very much in the script. You can almost hear his voice in it. Mm-hmm. That vocabulary and rhythm is so particular to him. Mm-hmm. When we first started, I thought maybe there was going to be a rehearsal period or that I had to learn my lines, you know, conclusively word for word, and once we got to set, he actually is quite the opposite of that. There's no firm control. Once he gives you your role, he really has given you your role. Mm-hmm. And however he instills that tone into his movies, it's a very natural sort of unmanipulative thing. It really just comes out of him, and like everyone that's drawn to the project seems right for it, and then it comes together in a very casual way. He's really sort of not precious about things. Once you've gotten all your lines out, he's like, okay, that was fine, let's go. But I play somebody who's really light. Her energy's tonally a little different from mine. Not that I'm like heavy or anything, but her buoyancy is what propels the story forward a little bit. It's late 1930s. You're in a world that is very attractive and shimmery, but totally superficial, and everyone's completely aware of it. Mm-hmm. And so this guy rolls into town with high hopes and ambition, experiences some serious disillusionment, falls in love, gets his heart broken by a girl because she actually chooses somebody else. And ultimately they carry on this sort of intermittent correspondence and sort of chance meetings, and they are somewhat related as well, technically. So they see each other throughout the course of their lives, and they sort of reflect on and reevaluate each other and value each other and hold each other despite their unconventional relationship. And placing that in the late 1930s and not applying guilt or shame to the woman who's carrying those things mm-hmm. out is really forward and cool and modern. And it was just, yeah, that was what I was mainly into.
So you didn't have any sense of intimidation about this at all? You just went into it and said, this is going to be a good experience for me.
Oh, no, I was dying. Yeah, I was
dying.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Before the audition, after the audition, the screen tests, you know, everyone working on that movie as well, they're all legends, you know, not just him. So
Steve Carell's your boss.
Yeah.
Jesse, who now, you're like this new team. This is your third movie with Jesse Eisenberg.
I know, we're going to be one of those like old Hollywood screen couples. They used to do that a lot. It's a cool, like when people pair up for multiple movies.
And you're happy with this. You don't look at each other and say, oh, you
I'm so over you.
Yeah. This is it. No, I just can't possibly be.
He's really one of
the very few people, Jesse, who has to play the Woody character, who does it with such naturalness. It's there.
It's really a good fit. Yeah. Woody says something interesting about that he's more comedic. That he says he's not an actor. He's like, I'm not an actor, I'm a comedian. So I hired a very good actor and he brought more life and humanity to the part than I ever would, because I would have played it satirical, which is interesting.
Lonnie, who you play, is an assistant to Steve Carell's character, who's a studio bigwig. And basically, she seems to be anti what Hollywood represents to Jesse's character.
Yeah.
and something else happens in the movie that makes her maybe not that anti, and what they're feeling. When you were born into this world of Los Angeles and making this, right?
I was born in L.A.
Yeah, born in L.A., so it has that. What's your feelings about Hollywood yourself? Are they mixed, or are you just saying this is a place I work?
I'm from L.A. My mom was a script supervisor while I was growing up, and my dad was a first AD for live television shows, very much entrenched in the Hollywood scene because actually he does like red carpets and more like television-based stuff, which, by the way, the rest of my family, because all my brothers are grips, my mom's scripty, and we're all like, oh, cool, dad, like, go do your live TV, we make art.
Nice.
Yeah, but...
Nice discussions around
it. But, like, to me, it's where I live and where I get to do what I really like to do. I've wanted to make movies since I was 9 years old, and, you know, all of the sort of floating... intangible sort of all the bull that I don't care about doesn't really it doesn't I don't associate that with like Hollywood. It's media, it's a business, it's a financially fueled business that I really try and just not consider. Because I get to make movies and live in LA, and I'm like the luckiest person in the entire world, so
Well, in this movie, when Jesse's character moves to New York, it's Cafe Society. It's this whole other world that's there. This has never been a part of where you come from. You're not this New York person.
Yeah, Cafe Society.
Even though you're here today.
Yeah, sometimes. You know, I can be a little highfalutin sometimes if I want to be. No, but I think we would ask Woody, like, okay, so the movie wasn't titled before it came out. So when we asked him about the title, because I didn't know what Cafe Society was, it really did refer to this group of young, sort of shiny things. These
bright
like
young things.
Bright young things. Yeah, there you go. And I've been asked recently if that still exists, and it's like, no, we have done a really good job at just like breaking that down and destroying
it.
But actually,
we have dumb young things.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What's wrong with it? We hate our young things. No, but it's actually better. Honestly, in my opinion, like it's not to say that there's any like realism in there's no sturdy realism that you can believe fully in our media obsession. But the fact that we're not putting people on crazy pedestals. It's nicer. There's more, you know, you look at a celebrity, you see them do normal things. So you can go like, oh, look, they have a booger in their nose. Oh, they have pimples today. That's cool. I think it's like more, to me, it's better because then you have like, you know, there's like less of a fall if you like, you know, become a human being publicly. So.
And yet within what you're playing here, there's the whole subject of adjusting to it. Or giving into it, I guess that's what I mean. And it seems like you've never given into it. It's like you have a streak of independence, a kind of steel, if I'm saying that.
Steel
but it's good,
train.
I mean, every time I see you, I see even more of that. It's like a sense of I'm gonna do this my way and still work with people that you wanna collaborate with.
That's cool.
Or have I just completely made that up?
No, that's really, that's nice, yeah, it's nice to hear. I definitely am.
We can say that.
Really?
That kind of show.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I genuinely do this because I like movies, and I can tell you that most people are lying when they tell you that they just love, you know, actors love to be looked at. I want to be as visible as I can be. I want to expose myself. I want to get closer to people through meditating on subjects and being like, this is it, this is my full open self. And that seems contradictory to somebody who also is like, believe me alone if I'm not doing that.
Now, I'm gonna do something really strange. I'm going to the future, we're equals.
Let's do it.
And another director that I really like, Drake Doremus, who's terrific, equals. What is it you're playing in this future?
I play a young woman who's got her emotions completely shut off. Genetically, they've been altered to live entirely progressively with an intellectual curiosity, but with one that's not tied to anything that could resemble an emotion, whether it's good or bad, hate, love, anything that takes your logic away from you, basically. Disease doesn't exist. They live in this sort of like utopian society. So you're given your sexuality, you're given your taste, you're given your humanity, like all of a sudden in one moment. So you're kind of born as an adult baby. And what happens is this defect becomes something that's rampant that people are starting to feel again. So these people start to fall in love and it's a problem.
And what's great about watching you and Nicholas Hoult in this movie is that it's all of this thing that's happening that isn't physicalized until much later.
Yeah, it's all about restraint.
Yeah.
It's about denying something really essential.
Yeah.
And it's painful. It's just that idea is pretty relevant to a lot of people for many different reasons. So like anytime you have to hide yourself, it's the worst feeling. You want to be seen for who you are and you want to be able to be that person and be the best version of that. And so if you stifle that, or if somebody doesn't see it, it almost doesn't exist. And so you want to show yourself to someone so you can exist.
How is Drake Doremus different than working for Woody Allen? Is he more hands-on in terms of what he's saying to you as an actor?
He shares his sort of willingness to allow his actors to own their parts, but at the same time, there is much more of a process. Rather than constructing a story or constructing character backstories, attributes, it was more about breaking, deconstructing and sort of becoming the most like base version of ourselves. And like, we did these rehearsal process or these rehearsal periods where we would sit in front of each other and say, hello, 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 just back
really?
And forth and back and
no,
forth.
Wait, like, that's what you're saying?
Yeah, it was like, hello, Nia, hello, Silas, hello, Nia, hello, Silas.
It either drives you crazy or it makes you better.
It kind of does both. It's weird. It's like, at first you're like, what are we doing? And then all of a sudden throughout the course of like 30 minutes, you go through like these peaks and valleys. You start to look at them and see something and feel like you know them on this weird, like sort of like soulful level, even though I don't know what street he was, you know, brought home to when he was born, what his mom's name is. I know nothing about this guy, but mm-hmm. suddenly I walk out of this room after an hour of saying hello to him. And it's like I've said hello to him in our office 365 days a year without further interaction. So now I have 365 hellos. I did it for real. You know what I mean? Like, and so when we start the movie, we're like, oh,
no,
hi.
This is incredible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's cool.
It's another movie you've done that I saw in Cannes, but nobody's seen it yet, Personal Shopper. Mm. But Olivia Assayas, who you did that movie with, you did Clouds of Sils Maria. It's the last time I saw you. Great performance in that.
Thanks.
You not only won the organization award that I'm part of, New York Film Critics Award, but the César.
Yeah.
The only American actress to win the French Oscar. What is
yeah.
that? Is there pressure? Does it feel good or what does it feel?
Oh, it's totally just kind of crazy. There was no pressure because it was weird that it even happened.
Yeah.
It's so cool. I don't know. Yeah, like it's
well, no, it's
yeah,
not
it's
a bad
surprising.
Thing.
No, it's
I
not
just
a
don't
bad
know
thing,
if it changes
saying.
You in any way as to the way you look at your life or the projects that you choose. You seem to be, and I mean this in the most admiring way I could about an actor doing things. It's like you could do a series of other kinds of movies. You could make sort of pseudo fake Twilights all your life mm-hmm. if you wanted to do it, and you choose not to do that. Do you have do the people that help you with your career want to do an intervention? Do they say
you
need
do...
to do a comic book movie now?
Right. If it was really good, I would do it. Like I
would you?
Oh yeah, totally.
There's nothing you've turned down.
No, like I give us more money to play with. That's awesome. More people will see it. That's great. As long as it's like whatever's in the center of it is worth protecting. If it's precious and there's like, you know, 100 people that are willing to like jump on and give everything they have to. Big movies can be that as well.
A while ago, a couple of years ago at Sundance, we were talking. You were playing Joan Jett mm-hmm. in The Runaways. And you said to me later, what was I going to do? And I said, well, I was just going to walk up and down. And you said, I wish I could do that. I can't do that. There were people that would come and find you and you wouldn't have that peace. Has it changed? Has the years since Twilight now made it easy for you to just get around in the world you live in?
I moved to a nice neighborhood.
And, where you can just walk in freedom.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. I deal with like, you know, paps sometimes, but they're not as consistently there. I used to live with them in my back pocket, several, 12, like all the time. So yeah, it's less. It's definitely, noticeably less. Also, I really like where I live. I have like my little places I go and it's pretty quaint.
All right, yeah. Every time I have you on the show, I tell you that this show ends in song. And
oh, no.
You tell me to go, you know what, to myself.
Yeah. Oh,
yes.
Go.
Which
oh,
is
boy.
So terrible. So
oh,
I think
I've never
now,
said that, but maybe.
But it, you did it in the eyes. I saw it, and if we were rehearsing for Equals, I would have seen it. You would say, what is this? And I thought maybe you'd have like a hum for me or something of the music. Because I don't know what music is going on in your head.
Do you know what's funny? What just occurred to me is the Mario Brothers tune. You know, when you finish like a, you jump off
you
something.
Do,
you go, yeah.
Yeah,
it's like, do-do-do-do-do-do. You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do.
I can't believe I got this.
I know. I can't believe that happened either. But it did.
This is so, I for the first time, at a loss for words. I can't do it. Thank you for that. Thank you so much.
Man.